Welcome to Faith That Works, exploring the changed lives of those living by faith. Your host, Bob McHouston, will spotlight ordinary people who have discovered for themselves a faith that works.
Thank you. We welcome you again to another segment of Faith That Works. Appreciate so much you watching the program. And we will say thank you for watching. And if you will allow us, we would love to send you a thank you card in the form of a booklet called The New Birth. A little booklet that I wrote a few years ago, and a little bit of my story, but it explains what it means to be born again. It's not a theological, exhaustive research. It's just simple, because the new birth is simple. The scripture is simple, really. Amen. And so it's just an explanation of what it really means to be born again. I grew up hearing that term, never knew what it meant until I experienced the new birth. And then I understood. So we would love to send you this booklet. If you'll call the number on the screen and just leave your name and your mailing address. Speak very slowly and very carefully. And I will put this booklet in the mail to you. And you won't hear from me again unless you call. Recently, I got a call from a lady and lives in the area, and she spoke very clearly, very distinctly. And I realized that when she told me what her address was, I thought, well, I'm going to be passing by that. So I just stopped by her apartment and gave her one of our booklets. And so if you give us a call. And let us give you, send you one of these booklets. And if you're in the area, and if I pass by your home, I'd just love to meet you. She and I had a wonderful time of fellowship together. And I know she's praying for this program. So again, I want to thank you for watching. And if you'll call the number on the screen, we would love to send you this booklet. And again, we don't compile a mailing list or a calling list. We don't even have that what's the thing on the phone that when they call, caller ID. We don't even have that. So you call and let us do this for you. Will you do that for us? Again, thank you for watching. Excited about the program we have tonight. Just met this couple and already experienced real fellowship, real oneness of the Spirit together. Mm-hmm. And so Abraham Hamilton III. And his wife, Maria Hamilton, and your pastor of a brand new church plant.
Yes, sir.
That started in your home. Is
yes,
that
sir.
Correct? We'll
yes,
talk
sir.
About that a little bit more, but the name of the church is Proximity Christian Fellowship. And we won't talk about that more as we get on into the program. But I want to mention this before we get started with the two of you, because of the supper we had tonight. We call it supper here. Some
I've
people
heard.
Call it dinner, but we call it, right. You call it supper.
Yeah, we call it dinner, but supper works just as well, too.
Right,
yeah.
Right.
It was wonderful. Doug and Tracy West provided our meal for us. And all of these people that do all this stuff are volunteers. Mm. And they're so gracious to come every couple of weeks, every 2 weeks, and do the cameras and do the sound and do all that stuff in the control room and bring me coffee and work the cameras and do all this stuff. And Doug and Tracy provided the meal for us tonight. Mm. It was wonderful.
Yes.
And just let me say this, Doug and Tracy own Capital Bedding, a mattress manufacturing plant in Verona, Mississippi. And if you need some type of mattress, twin, king, queen, full, whatever, you can call Capital Bedding. I don't have their number right now, but it's listed in the phone book in Verona, Mississippi. Capital Bedding, and you can buy direct from the factory. You cut out the middleman, so you can you save a lot of money by buying direct from the factory. And I know this fella, he's trustworthy, he's dependable. I've been knowing him for years. and they're the ones that provided supper for us. So I just want to plug his business and encourage you to check him out, check his prices. Matter of fact, I'm sleeping on one of his mattresses right now at home. So do that, would you? That's Capital Bedding, Doug West. Now, Abraham Hamilton III and Maria, we're going to talk.
Let's talk.
Okay? So that the people can get an idea of sort of who you are, tell us a bit about yourselves. Where'd you come from? You come from New Orleans.
Yes, sir.
Maria, did you come from New Orleans also?
Well, yes, when we moved here, but originally I'm from Puerto Rico.
Puerto Rico?
Yes. Mm-hmm.
And when did you come to the States?
In 1998. So it's been about,
18 years.
So. Yeah.
So originally from Puerto Rico, I was born there.
So you've only been here a couple of years then?
Yeah.
Yeah.
So my family moved to Houston, Texas. Mm-hmm. And that's where we met. And then we moved to New Orleans 5 years ago, I guess now.
Okay.
Yeah.
So your family lives in Texas now?
All over, actually, now. I have some that are still in Houston, some in Florida, some in northern part of Texas. We're everywhere. And then I'm in Mississippi, so.
So how old were you when you moved to?
I was 13 years old.
13. Mm-hmm. Did you speak English at that time?
I did, because God just had it all planned out perfectly.
Yep, he always did.
Yeah, I grew up in an I went to an American school.
Wow.
So I spoke Spanish at home. My parents only spoke Spanish to us, and we spoke Spanish in our neighborhood, community, and everything. But in school, it was all English. And so I learned both at the same time, I guess you could say. Spanish at home, but then English at school. And so when I came, I was already bilingual. I was already able to speak English.
I'm still trying to learn English.
Yeah.
Me too.
Yeah.
That's wonderful.
So it worked out well.
Well, while I'm talking to you, Maria, did you grow up in church? You got a church background?
No, unfortunately, I did not at all.
Really?
If you know a little bit about Hispanic countries, they're very Catholic traditionally.
Yes.
And so I grew up, this is strange, but I grew up saying I was Catholic, but never really practiced any of the traditions that the Catholic Church does. So never, I mean, all I did was the sprinkling baptism when I was a baby, and then First Communion, and that was really it. My family was not religious at all. And so then we fast forward, and when we moved to Houston, I was attending a church just because I felt and I knew that that God was real, but I didn't know anything about him.
Right.
And so I started going to this church with a friend.
It was a Catholic church? Or?
No, and non-denominational, right, because it was just traditionally at growing up that Catholicism was all around me, but I didn't understand it. I didn't really even realize that there were two different denominations, if you will, you know, Catholic versus everything else, and I just didn't understand all that. So. When I was 16, I was attending a church and I got saved because I really felt what I know now to be the Holy Spirit really drawing me to him, because I knew I was lost and I knew I needed a Savior. And I was 16 years old. But I did not start living for him until later in life. Maybe I think at 22 is when I was started to be transformed, if you will. You know.
What brought you to that place?
To that church, a friend.
No, to that 22 years
to
old.
To the 20, right, that's good. So at 16, I get saved because I know it was a moment in church when I felt, okay, I need to get saved. I need the Lord, right? And but then I was never taught beyond that what it looked like, what it was about, who Jesus really was, and that transformation hadn't occurred yet. So then I go to college, and I'm living the same way that I was living before. Mm-hmm. But then when I graduated, I really felt, and I tell him the story all the time, because I really felt like there was an emptiness. There was something there that was not full. I always say you get the sheet of paper and they ask you, are you a Christian? And you mark yes, because you have to say yes, because if you say no, then you know, whoa. So you say yes, but you don't really understand what that means. So that's who I was. I was a Christian, but didn't really live it. So when I graduated, I felt like there was an emptiness. There was something there. There was something more that I just didn't have in my life yet. And once I met him, it was all at the same time. It's crazy to explain, because I was seeking the Lord and I was searching, but on my own.
Mm-hmm.
And I didn't have a church home at the time once I had graduated from college. And I didn't know where to go to get the answers. And I would read the scriptures and I wouldn't really fully understand them. Mm-hmm. And so then when I met him, I was at that time aware of Christianity, and I was aware of people who claimed to be Christians.
Yeah.
But the people that I had encountered were, let me say this properly, but they were church attenders.
Yeah.
They were going to church. They were around the things of
not
the Lord.
Not a whole lot of difference in them and you.
Exactly. Yeah. And that is really what I was like, wait, there's something more to this. There has to be.
Yeah.
Because my life looks just like it did before.
Right.
So getting to know him, really, a lot of questions were answered for me. Mm. And we can go into that if you want, but it was just a lot of how he had been living his life that really really helped me to get to the place where I really gave my life over fully to God.
Mm-hmm.
And understood and grew in that, you know, and understood what that looked like. A lot more then.
That's, you know, when we get hungry, God's going to find some way to feed us.
Amen. That's right.
He really is.
That's right.
He really is.
That's the truth.
God's so wonderful.
Amen.
He's so personal.
That's right.
And he cares about your needs, your desires.
Yes.
And he'll do whatever he has to do to give you those desires, and he'll fulfill those desires.
Amen.
Delight yourself in
Amen.
The Lord,
mm-hmm. yes.
and he will give you the desires of your heart.
Amen.
That's right. That's right.
He'll put those desires there.
Mm-hmm.
Amen.
He's the one that gave you the hunger.
That's right.
To say, yes, it's all Holy Spirit.
Yeah.
That's right.
Yeah.
That's right.
He gave you the hunger to grow, and then
places
he put somebody in your life.
That's right.
That's right.
That's right.
To help you grow.
It really blew me away in the way that it happened. He was having a Bible study in his apartment when we met, and
a single guy.
Single guy
having a Bible study in his apartment.
Yes, but
that's crazy.
There were other individuals there, and so he said. So I approached him at work because we're working together, and I asked him, you know, what you do in this office. And long story short, he mentioned a key phrase that I always said, never will forget it. He said, "My faith is very important to me." And that to me was more than just I go to church or
yeah.
I'm a Christian or, you know,
yeah.
the same answers that you hear.
Yeah.
He said, my faith is very important to me. So that told me there was something different.
Mm-hmm.
And I was like, who are you and what are you talking about?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So I started going to his Bible study, and the Lord really started opening my eyes to the thing that I was missing, which was full surrender.
Yeah.
I understood that, you know, you need to be good and you needed to read the scriptures and pray. But how do you live a life of full surrender? I didn't know what that looked like. And so this fine gentleman here really downloaded into me what all it looked like, because he had been living it. He had been living it. He had been being led by the Spirit of God and really making decisions, really following God in his life. And that's what I was missing. I was missing a full surrender.
That's the reason he can teach what it looks like.
Yes.
We can talk above our experience, and we can't teach above our experience. Mm.
That's good. That's good.
Mm.
Yeah. He had been living it.
And so he was experiencing the surrendered life, the abundant life, the relationship.
Mm-hmm. Exactly.
He
exactly.
was experiencing it, so he could teach.
That's right. That's
about
right.
it.
That's exactly right.
And a lot of people, we got a lot of people on Sunday mornings preaching. Ooh. From knowledge, not from experience.
Mm.
Mm. But I'll hush there because I'll.
That's good. That's really good.
So, Abraham, did you grew up in New Orleans?
I did.
She grew up in Puerto Rico.
Yes, sir.
And then God brought a Hurricane Katrina.
Only the way he knows how to do.
And brought you out of Puerto Rico.
That's right.
Put you both in Houston.
That's right.
It blows me away just thinking about it. It really does.
Yeah. And you know it.
Completely different parts of the world. Completely different upbringings.
Yeah.
Completely separate. And he just makes it all happen, you know.
Yeah.
Here we are.
I never dreamed I would live anywhere other than New Orleans.
Really?
Never did. Mm-mm. Never thought it. Never crossed my mind.
But Katrina is what got you out of New Orleans.
I would say the Lord got me out of New Orleans.
Yeah. He used
Katrina
he
was just
a hurricane.
Katrina was just the wind he used to blow me out.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. I was in my third year of law school, and I didn't even know all this was going on in her. I was in my third year of law school when Katrina hit, and it ended up moving me to Houston, Texas. And so I ended up passing the bar and practicing law in Texas. And the way that Marie and I met is I was in the Family Criminal Law Division in the Harris County District Attorney's Office, which is the division where I handled domestic violence cases, but specifically when victims will recant. So there will be a woman primarily will suffer abuse, but for a number of reasons, often was because the women were financially dependent upon the men, they would change their stories after the fact. Those are the cases I was prosecuting at that time. And I was preparing for a trial for one of these cases, and the witness that I was preparing to for trial with was a Spanish speaker. And the normal translator in the office who I used, she wasn't there that day. Mm. And so the secretary told me, well, there's a new girl who started in the office today. She's in HR right now, but when she comes back, I'll bring her to your office. Well, I'm at my desk doing my work. I hear a knock on my door, and it's my wife standing in my doorway with the secretary. And so a week after that is when she and I started getting to know one another, and I told her, and actually I learned that when we met, she was actually in the middle of a fast. She was fasting. Wow. The day we met, she was fasting.
Yeah.
And one of the first questions she asked me was about fasting. And I told her, it's amazing, because I didn't think about this now, but the Bible study primarily was all guys, and I didn't intentionally set out to do that, but she would ask me questions, and I said, well, hey, I'm teaching this Bible study, and I didn't really expect her to be interested, but she was interested. And I remember in the Bible study, she wouldn't say much, but she would just be writing feverishly in her notebook. And it wasn't until we got married that I realized what God was doing in her life through the Bible study. Because I didn't think what I was sharing was all that life-shattering, anything like that. The concept that she shared, that she says that she now knew she needed, that was the teaching about being fully surrendered to the Lord. I mean, because I remember I told her early on, I said, you know, I'm a lawyer, but if God calls me to leave the practice of law, I'll drop that like a bad habit and run hard after the things of God. And prior to meeting her, every person I'd ever said anything like that to, they thought I was crazy.
Yeah.
You know, but she didn't. And the Lord showed me over time that her heart for him was so big, and she had the hunger. And I recognized that that was the type of woman I wanted to be my wife. Mm-hmm. And so I have a saying that it doesn't take a whole day to recognize sunshine, especially when you've been in the dark a long time.
Yeah.
So I made it my business to pursue.
And you won her over.
And here we are. Almost 9 years. 9 years and 4 kids later.
Yeah.
Here we are.
I just met those wonderful kids.
Yeah.
So you grew up actively involved in church, or?
Yeah, I grew up in church. I'm so grateful to God for that. I got saved as a young kid, 7 or 8 years old, and I really began standing for my faith at about my sophomore, junior year in high school. Mm. Evangelism, you know, all of those things. That's where I put my finger on really beginning to pursue the Lord for myself. That led me, I played basketball in high school, I played basketball in college, but the Lord really began to turn my heart to ministry. Now, when I say ministry, I don't want anybody to confuse that with anything around the pulpit, because the Lord impressed upon my heart the Great Commission, and the Lord calls all of his disciples to ministry. Mm-hmm. You know, so I didn't necessarily think that meant anything, any pulpit vocation or anything, but my heart was turned toward ministry beginning in high school and more so through college. And following college, I felt the Lord leading me to minister through the legal field.
Mm-hmm.
And so that's what I pursued. And I still was engaged in preaching and teaching, but I never saw myself as becoming a pastor of any sort. I never desired it, actually, because I was fully given over to the Lord in the field that I was in. But as time progressed, the Lord started pulling my heart more and more and more to be more involved in you know, pulpit ministry and things of that nature. And so over time, I gave myself to that. So after being in Houston about 6 years, living and practicing law, the Lord called me to go back to New Orleans to my home church where I'd grown up to be involved there as a teaching pastor in that church. I wasn't the senior pastor. I just did a lot of the teaching under the supervision and the authority of the lead pastor there.
Were you practicing law at that time?
And I still practiced law there. I still practiced law. And so I continued being a trial lawyer, prosecuting attorney in the New Orleans area while bivocationally teaching in the church on Sunday and doing a bunch of other different things. And through that, I end up, by chance, one of my friends from the church where we both actually grew up in New Orleans worked at the American Family Association. And following the Lord again, the Lord put it on my heart just to visit him, introduce him to my wife. He had never met my wife, our children, to get together and play. And through that, he asked me, would I be willing to do devotions at the American Family Association? I said, sure, I'll do it. And lo and behold, God had a plan. I did the devotions, and the next thing you know, I'm sitting in the boardroom with Mr. Tim Wildman talking about coming over to AFA. And so that's how my wife and I, we got here to Mississippi.
And that was, when was this?
That was in September of 2015, right, when that happened. And my family and I moved here in January of this year.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
So you're fairly new to
the area.
This mm-hmm. area.
Yes, sir.
This is just out of curiosity.
Mm-hmm.
You were a prosecuting attorney.
Yes, sir.
So you have a lot of enemies in jail. Huh?
You could say that. You could say that, but I hope not as many as when, as before the trials began, because I prayed for the individuals who I prosecuted as well, because jail isn't the end of life. You mm-hmm. know, and then there are many that the Lord would use their incarceration as a means to
yes.
confront them with the gospel.
Yes.
So my prayer has been and continues to be that those whose lives I touched through that system would meet Christ ultimately
mm-hmm.
As a result of where they are currently.
So you can prosecute more aggressively with that kind of motive in mind.
Hmm. Absolutely. Yeah. Because, you know, there's a difference between judgment and condemnation.
Yeah.
You know, and
how would you explain the difference?
Yeah, judgment is an evaluation of conduct. Condemnation is an eternal judgment. So and as Paul said, if it wasn't for the law, I would have known what sin was.
Mm-hmm.
And for some of us, our circumstances are so dire, we require some sort of external confrontation
yes.
to cause us to really stop and to consider what we have become.
Mm-hmm.
And for some, it takes that. Not all, but some.
It does. It does. The bottom is just farther down for some of us than it is others.
Mm-hmm. That's right.
We have to hit bottom.
That's right.
Yeah.
We all have to hit bottom.
Yes, yes.
Yep.
And I was so far down, I had to look up to see bottom when Jesus came into my life.
Mm.
I surrendered to him out of desperation.
Mm.
Wow.
I tried everything and nothing worked.
Mm-hmm. Right.
And I was broke and lost everything and had no idea what I was going to do, what was going to happen.
Yeah.
So I praise God that he brought me to the bottom.
Mm.
Praise God.
And I lost it all and found everything.
Amen.
I was just telling him this morning how, because my family, a lot of members of my family are not saved.
Mm.
And, you know, of course I pray that the Lord will save their souls and, they, you know, that the Lord would draw them to him as he did with me. But because they're my family members, you know, we have that connection. And sometimes I have to pray, Lord, shake them up.
Yes, yes.
You know, get them to the place where you know, they need you.
Yes.
And that's kind of, because then they're going to come and call, and I'm in desperate need, and I'm like, okay, this is what you
Amen.
Need.
Amen.
You know? It's
well,
hard,
praise
but
God.
It's the truth. Amen, right. It's
when,
hard,
when
but it's
when they
it's
say
what
it on the phone, you don't want to shout in their ear, but
right,
you're,
right,
you're
right.
Glad.
And that's the real, that's real.
Yeah.
That's real. Otherwise, they keep fighting, they keep doing what they're doing.
Yeah.
Otherwise, they will continue to figure life out, you know, in the flesh.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And that's where they are.
And it always ends up with a hollow answer.
Yeah. Yes.
It really does.
Yeah, they keep searching, and
yeah.
they will never find them.
Yeah.
Yeah.
right quick, we only got a couple minutes left. Tell me about this new You started a Bible study in your home here in Tupelo.
Yes.
What happened?
Yeah. Too many people, well, not too many, but people kept coming where I couldn't fit it all in my home anymore. And it's just a simple, the Lord has put a passion in my heart for making disciples. Mm-hmm. You know, the Great Commission has always been and always will be to go into all the world and make disciples. And sometimes in the body of Christ, we can conflate the notion of making disciples with the simple proclamation of the gospel. But when people submit themselves to Christ as a result of receiving the gospel, that's not the end of the story. That's the beginning oftentimes. Mm-hmm. And just carrying that passion and also indicating the fact that the Lord has blessed many of us with the first iterations of fulfilling the Great Commission by giving us a family.
Yep.
You know, all too often, some in the body of Christ sacrifice the Jerusalem of the Great Commission mandate in order to fulfill the ministry in Samaria and the uttermost parts of the world. Mm-hmm. But when we neglect the Jerusalem, we affect the potency of the body of Christ going forward. So just sharing the gospel and really teaching and training men to be the shepherds, the pastors of their homes, mm-hmm. Caused the Bible study just to continue to grow. And the Lord opened the door for us to have a place to meet outside of my home now. And that's where we are now. Still a very young, early move, but it is the early stages of a church plant.
If somebody was interested and wanted to attend, what would phone number or address or what?
The address would be at 100 Park Gate Extension in Tupelo. It's close to Skate Zone. It's where we meet in Skate Zone close to Skate Zone here in Tupelo.
You pass the skating rink.
Keep going.
That dead end.
Right at the dead end. That's right. And we meet on Saturdays because the place is gracious enough to allow us to use the building on Saturdays. And if anybody's interested, they can find me on Facebook if you use social media, Abraham Hamilton III. I can give you more information there. And we just are running hard after the Lord mm-hmm. and with a passion to see the light of Christ erected. You know, I think one of the best ways to do so is by fulfilling that or responding to that call to make disciples.
A disciple is more than just someone who observes and watches Christians. There's a difference in a disciple or a fan and a disciple.
Yes,
that's right.
A lot of fans on church on Sunday morning. They're all for Jesus.
Yeah.
Right. Just to be clear, I wanted to say the name of the church. You forgot to say it. It's Proximity Christian Fellowship.
Uh huh.
So
interdenominational church.
Yes.
Okay. Great. Folks, we want to tell you we appreciate you watching, and I pray that you're encouraged and challenged by what these testimonies that you've heard. God is sovereign. He's in control. He's got a plan for your life. He really does. He loves you. Listen to Him. Surrender to Him and watch Him change your life because He loves you supremely.